stand together for the pledge. Okay, put your right hand in your heart. Amen. And let's pledge. I pledge allegiance to the Bible. Amen. You may be seated. Today, as I promised that I'm going to be preaching about parables for the whole year. So, here's another one. Today, I'm going to talk about the parable of the importunate cow. Am I using some big words in here? But importunate means making repeated or annoying requests or demands. And of course, pal, you know pal, right? You call your friends pal. Pal means a close friend, a buddy, amigo, comrade, compadre. That's what we usually call in the Philippines. Confidant, musketeer, mate. Or in Australia, they will call it mate. Okay. In the Middle East, hospitality is more than the courteous thing to do. It is an important obligation. And you know what? The Filipinos, we are known for our hospitality as well. Did you know that? We have this phrase that we say to our guests, tuloy po kayo. That means, you are welcome. Amen? So to neglect hospitality to a guest is unthinkable to these people, and even maybe to the Filipinos. Let me tell you a story about Prophet Elijah and a rabbi. So there was a rabbi on a journey with Prophet Elijah. They walked all day, and at nightfall they came to the humble home of a poor man whose only treasure was a cow. So the poor man ran out of his house, and his wife ran to welcome the strangers for the night and to offer them all the simple hospitality which they were able to give in such poor circumstances. Elijah and the rabbi were entertained with plenty of the cow's milk, sustained by homemade bread and butter, and they were put to sleep in the best bed while their kindly host lay down before the kitchen fire. But in the morning, the poor man's cow died. So they walked the next day, all day long, and came that evening to another house. At this time, it is at the house of a very wealthy merchant, whose hospitality they craved. The merchant was cold, proud, but he's very rich. And all that he would do for the prophet and the rabbi was to lodge them in a cow shed and feed them on bread and water. In the morning, however, Elijah thanked him very much for what he had done and sent for a mason to repair one of his walls, which happened to be falling down, as a return for his kindness. Now, are you thinking? So the rabbi, unable to keep silence any longer, he begged Elijah to explain the meaning of his dealings with human beings. So Prophet Elijah told the rabbi, in regards to the poor man who received us so hospitably, it was decreed that his wife was to die that night. But in reward for his goodness, God took the cow instead of the wife. I repaired the wall of the rich, stingy merchant because a chest of gold was concealed near the place. And if the rich, stingy merchant had repaired the wall himself, he would have discovered the treasure. Did you get the story? Okay. Jesus was raised in a culture where hospitality was a high value. The Jewish people, from Abraham down to the Lord Jesus Christ history, you will see examples of hospitality. The Old Testament is full of this. From Abraham, Lot, Laban, Jethro, Manoah, Samuel, David, Barzillai, the Shunammite woman, and others offered hospitality. With such a high value, and look at this, they don't have any convenience stores. You can imagine the acute sense of anxiety of the man whose friend arrives for a visit about midnight. He must feed his visitor. That he has no bread in the house is not an excuse. So let us go and let's read our text today. It will be in the Gospel of Luke, chapter 11, beginning in verse 5 through 13. Okay, let's all stand together to read this. Amen. Okay, let's read it together. Then Jesus said to them,
disciples asked him, Lord, teach us how to pray.
And of course, the Lord Jesus showed them, how are we going to pray? And he said, and most of us memorize this, right? The Lord's Prayer. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Amen. Right? We do that. Prayer is communication with God, and that it is an act of worship in which a person communicates with God the Father through the access provided by the Son and by the prompting of the Holy Spirit. This morning, we are going to learn that Jesus not only encourages us to pray, but insists on how we should pray. So, let's look at our text today. We will find the very first two verses there. That a man goes to his neighbor's house and calls to his neighbor inside, probably trying to wake him up, and appeals to him as a friend. The Greek word used here is philos, an adjective that means love, dear, loving, devoted, as well as a noun as found in our verse, friend. It is the way a person addresses one with whom he is in good terms. So, you have to understand the word philos is from the Greek word phileo, one of the Greek words for love, a brotherly love. So, friendship is one of the important elements of this parable. Notice that the word friend was mentioned four times in our passage. So let's look at the first two verses here. Then he said to them, this is the Lord Jesus Christ, telling them the parable. Suppose one of you has a friend, and he goes to him at midnight and says, Fele, kreison moi tres artos. Friend, lend me three loaves of bread, because a friend of mine on a journey has come to me, and I have nothing to set before him. Jesus' point is this. As strong as the bond of friendship is, it is not strong enough to get this man out of his bed in the middle of the night. Now look at verse 7. Then the one inside answers, don't bother me. The door is already locked, and my children are with me in bed. I can't get up and give you anything. Now, if you look at this, it's like, why can't he not get up? Right? It's like, okay, let me go to my refrigerator and take some food in there and go to the door, open the door, and give it to him. Why can't he not get up and do that? Now, you have to understand, this is the first century. Okay? According to Harper's Encyclopedia of Bible Life, the typical poor Israelite family lived in a one-room house. A studio, huh? We call it studio nowadays. And in many poorer homes, the house also served as a part-time stable for the family's animals, like sheep, the goats, the chickens. And all family members would sleep in the same room, in the same bed. No privacy at all. And of course, sometimes this place is on a raised platform, perhaps 18 inches higher than the floor of the rest of the house. So the family could eat and sleep without constant intrusions by their animals. Family members usually slept with their clothes on, of course, covering themselves with the clothes they had worn during that day. They would sleep side by side on straw mats rolled out at night. It reminds me of some poorer homes in the Philippines that is built in a what we call a nipaha, right? And they have at least they have a floor that is bamboo, and at the bottom of that floor where your chickens may be, or your other animals, right? And of course they have a rolled mat that they unrolled it during the night to sleep. So getting a whole family to bed was a considerable undertaking. Isn't that right, parents? Right?
Yes.
Once children are asleep, parents want to keep them that way. Right? So once the chickens were asleep, the parents would want to keep them that way too. And look at this, the door was locked. The poorest homes had a bar across the door, which serves as a lock. That's their lock at that time. You know, they have a bar. You see this in the movies, right? So since the door was locked, the friend couldn't just let himself in, right? And get the bread he needed. So the father would have to get up quietly from the sleeping area, find the bread in the food storage area, and cross the area where the animals were at the door. Unlock the door and give the bread to his friend. There would be no way to keep the household from waking up. Right? So what is the Lord trying to tell his listeners here, and as well as today? Today I would like to share with you three things that the Lord wants us to know about prayer. That when we pray, we should do this. First, we should pray shamelessly. Look at verse 8. I tell you, though he will not get up and give him the bread because he is his friend, look at this, yet because of the man's shamelessness or boldness, he will get up and give him as much as he needs. Look at that. So as strong as his friendship with the man is, it is not strong enough for him to wake up his whole family. But the man's boldness tips the scale in Jesus' parable here. The Greek word is the noun anaideia, which means impudence, very rude, literally shamelessness. Maybe I'm going to use another word, and embarrassed. How's that? So the point of the parable, of course, is the importance of boldness, and embarrassed, not ashamed at all. The friend has no sense of decency of waiting until morning, of not disturbing his sleepy friend. He goes at midnight and knocks at the door for some bread. And he shamelessly keeps on knocking until his friend gets up and shoves bread at him just to shut him up. Shamelessness. Boldness. That's what the parable illustrates. Jesus told this parable to call Christians to shamelessly and boldly ask the Father to help them in times of need. An important difference, however, is that God the Father is not answering from a locked house. If you truly need God, boldly come before Him in prayer and shamelessly ask Him for what you need. You know what? If you have trouble understanding what shamelessly looks like, go to any toy store like Toys R Us and watch a child asking his or her parents, "Can I have this one?" Have you seen those kids? Huh? Okay. That's what we call boldness. I'm embarrassed, you know? They will do anything to get what they want. They want that toy. And what do? Oh my goodness, they will roll in the floor. They will scream on top of their throat. Have you saw this before? Maybe it happened to your one of your kids. That's the picture of chains, boldness. That's how the Lord wants us when we come to the Father for prayer. We need to come boldly. Amen? Because He gave us that opportunity. He gave us that wonderful privilege that we could come to Him at any time, boldly, into His throne of grace and receive mercy. Amen? The second thing that the Lord wants us to learn from this parable, when we pray, is that we need to pray persistently. Look at verses 9 and 10. So I say to you, ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and the door will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives. He who seeks finds. And to him who knocks, the door will be opened. Jesus gives us three pairs that have to do with prayer here. Three pairs of words. The first is the action. The second is the result. The first word in each pair is the Greek present tense that can carry the idea of an action in progress in present time. So they call this in English progressive present tense. So Jesus' command here has the effect of saying, do this and keep on doing it. So Jesus said, ask and keep on asking. Seek and keep on seeking. Knock and keep on knocking. The second word in each pair is in the future tense. The expectation. The promise. So let's look at the first one. The Greek word used in Jesus' command are very common. So the first one was aitheo, means ask. Ask for or demand. The idea is asked for as a petition. And the promise in Greek, didome, the common word for give. So ask and it will be given to you. The second pair, the Greek zeiteo, which means seek, look for in order to find. And the corresponding result is expressed by the Greek word eurisko. You know, the Californians, they have this state motto. Do you know their state motto? Eureka, from the word eurisko. Eureka means, I have found it. It means literally to find, discover, come upon, and can also refer figuratively to intellectual discovery based upon reflection, observation, examination, investigation. So seek and you shall find. The third pair of words express the figure of seeking by knocking on a door until it is opened. The Greek word here is kruo, means beat a door with a stick to gain admittance. The corresponding promise is the Greek word anoigo, which means to open. So knock and the door will be opened to you. So here the Lord is trying to tell us, we are to keep on asking. This is what we do when we are certain that the one we are imploring is near and can hear. We are to keep on seeking. This expects action on our part. We have to actively look for the one we are imploring. And of course, we are to keep on knocking. This expects further action after having located the one we are in glory. It pictures us as persistently banging on the door to get the person's attention. The main point here is that God wants us to pray this way. He wants us to have to be persistent and to have to wait for answers from God. Have you ever secretly thought that God must get tired of your repeated prayers? Or that you might annoy Him with bringing the same request over and over again? If so, Jesus wants you to know that God never gets tired of your prayers.
Amen.
You know, we are only naturally persistent in our prayers when someone close to us is sick. Or if one of our children becomes ill, we pray without ceasing. Likewise, if we are in financial trouble, or if we are hoping for a promotion, or if we have a frightening or dangerous task ahead of us, we generally find it easy to pray.
Amen.
But do we persist in prayers for spiritual growth for ourselves, or maybe for others? Do we ask? Do we seek? And do we knock for a pure mind? Do we keep on knocking for a forgiving spirit or for the removal of an angry or critical spirit? I think that Christians usually don't do it. Consider what would happen if God's people understood what Christ is saying here and put it to work. The third thing that the Lord Jesus wants us to learn when we pray is we need to pray expectantly. Look at verse 10. For everyone who asks receives, and the one who seeks finds, and to the one who knocks it will be opened. Jesus is telling us today to pray expectantly. In verses 11 to 12, Jesus asked a rhetorical question to indicate that we serve a good God who is loving, and He is our Father. He asked, "Which of you fathers, if your son asks for a fish, will give him a snake instead? Or if he asks for an egg, will give him a scorpion?" See, the obvious answer is that only a wicked father would do that. Only a wicked father would do such a thing. Any father who did such things would be evil. But Jesus says then, in verse 13, "If you then, who are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask Him?" Did you see what Jesus did in His response here? His hearers would have correctly thought only an evil father would give those bad gifts. Jesus then tells them that they are evil, yet they give good gifts to their children. Jesus is highlighting the ability of all humans to show love even though they are dead in their trespasses and by nature, children of wrath. Jesus is arguing from the lesser to the greater. Look at this. If humans who are spiritually dead, lesser, are able to give good gifts to their children, how much more is God, who is the epitome of spiritual life, the greater, able to give good gifts to His children? Jesus says in verse 13, "How much more will your heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask Him?" This verse is important because it reminds us not to use our verses this morning for our own selfish desires. You know, too often Christians will read, "Ask and it will be given to you, and interpreted to mean I can ask for anything regardless of its eternal value. You know, when Jesus says that God the Father will give the Holy Spirit to those who ask Him, He is reminding us that our asking, our seeking, and our knocking are in the context of His name being hallowed, His coming kingdom, His will being done on earth as it is in heaven, His provision of daily bread, His forgiveness of our sins, and His protection in temptation. Our receiving from God must be understood that He will give His children what they need, even if it is not what they think they need. J.C. Ryle, in his expository thoughts on this parable, said, "There are few promises in the Bible so broad and unqualified as those contained in this wonderful passage. The last in particular deserves special notice. The Holy Spirit is beyond doubt the greatest gift which God can bestow upon man. Having this gift, we have all things: life, light, hope, and heaven. Having this gift, we have the God the Father's boundless love, God the Son's atoning blood, and full communion with all three persons of the Blessed Trinity. Having this gift, we have grace and peace in the world that now is, glory and honor in the world to come. And yet, this mighty gift is held out by our Lord Jesus Christ as a gift to be obtained by prayer. Your Heavenly Father shall give the Holy Spirit to those who ask Him." Jesus tells us to pray shamelessly and with confidence draw near to the throne of grace that we may receive mercy and find grace in time of need. Jesus tells us to pray persistently and remember that God will give justice to His elect who cry to Him day and night. Jesus tells us to pray expectantly and trust that every good and perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of lights, who does not change like shifting shadows. So pray shamelessly, pray persistently, and pray expectantly to your good God who delights in answering the prayers of His children. Amen. Did you get the message today?
Amen.
Let us go to God in prayer. Our Heavenly Father, hallowed be Your name. May Your kingdom come and Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. In this moment, Lord, we ask that these words may come with fresh and vital meaning to our heart, that we may see that there is a vast and great experience of Your blessing and power lying before us, waiting for us to step out upon the basis of the Word alone, that there are things we need to ask for and take immediately from Your hand, others that we need to seek for, and still others to which we need to knock and wait and knock again, knowing that in every case, without exception, Your word is sure. Your answer is true. It shall be given. We shall find. And it shall be opened. Amen.